we're poisoning our children. And this is just shameful, given that 46 years ago, the Surgeon General in 1971 said, lead poisoning is a problem, all children should be tested, and if their levels are high, they should be treated. And 7 years later, lead paint was banned because lead paint is the main source of lead poisoning in children. The kids eat the lead chips and just the dust they inhale and ingest. But Syracuse is not alone in New York City, or the nation really. New York City and Rochester have doubled the rates of child lead blood levels, or those with blood levels above the safe standard of Flint, Michigan, which has got a lot of attention because their lead service lines were corroded by a new water system and had an epidemic of lead poisoning. And we've had a lot of news this week, in the last month really, about the problems with the New York City Housing Authority, NYCHA. Their leadership lied to the feds about the lead testing and treatment they were doing. And then when the city was pressured, they undercounted grossly the number of children that had been poisoned. They used the 10 micrograms per deciliter standard, that's the state standard still, rather than the 5 micrograms per deciliter standard, which is the new federal standard since 2012 from the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. So Mayor de Blasio has been catching hell on that, and Governor Cuomo has, of course, attacked de Blasio for that, but provided no money, really, to deal with the lead. He put some money in the NYCHA, $250 million, but they got mold, they got boilers that don't work, elevators don't work, roofs that need to be replaced. So it really wasn't focused on the lead, and there is no statewide program for Governor Cuomo. And then here in Syracuse, where we've got the worst crisis in the country, the city lost its federal funding because they also misreported to the feds and did faulty lead testing. And that was under Mayor Minor, who is now running for governor's administration in 2015. So these misplaced priorities are what we're getting from the Democrats that call themselves progressive. They seem to be more interested in their real estate donors than the health of our children. So I'm today calling for 5 reforms in New York State to address this problem. First, the state should adopt the federal standard of 5 micrograms per deciliter rather than 10 micrograms per deciliter. That's what the medical science says it should be. That's what the state should have. Secondly, and I called for this when I was mayor for the city, but I think we should go statewide, no unit should be rented out without lead safe certification. We should not be poisoning our children. Renting units where children are going to be poisoned is really just a crime. And what that will do, because it's going to be a big cost to abate this lead, but this will get landlords to invest money as well, because we're going to need a private contribution. And I'd allow for time to phase that in, but not too much time, because the kids are getting poisoned. The third thing is that the state should adopt the federal standards for lead abatement certification. The state is pretty good on asbestos, has a good program, but if you read the environmental groups and what they've been reporting on lead abatement, we really don't have a good program in the state, and the certification is really not that good. The fourth thing is that we should have annual testing of drinking water in our schools. At Blodgett, I don't know if the lead's been tested. I don't know if it's been tested for the water or the paint. You know, this is an old building, it's probably got lead paint, but the water faucets they can't use in there because they're rusty. But the National NRDC, National Resource Defense Council, did a study of New York and found 80% of the drinking fountains, or 82% of the schools have drinking fountains with lead above the standard of 15 parts per billion. So we got to have annual testing and remediation of drinking water in our schools. And finally, the state's got to make an investment in this without it being an unfunded mandate. They got to put the money up for lead inspections and abatement. And just to show how that's worked, or what the needs are in Syracuse, we just passed a new law earlier this year to inspect 1 and 2 family units as well as 3+ family units. And the problem is we don't have enough inspectors to do the 3 family units. We need more inspectors. Secondly, our inspectors in the codes division are not lead certified, so they really can't even inspect for the lead. So we need money to upgrade that. Rochester, which has had probably the best progress on this issue in the state, has been doing inspections intensively of all rental housing since 2005, and they've been able to reduce the number of kids with above the 10 deciliter standard by 85%. The problem is, like New York City, they aren't using the new federal standard. So, and it's still a problem in Rochester. So their program was half funded by the state. I don't know the details of where they got the state funding, but obviously the cities, and particularly Syracuse, which is in a fiscal crisis, needs that money. So the state's got to step up. We got to get our priorities straight. Our children should not be being poisoned by a problem we identified 46 years ago.
How substantial is that difference in deciliters from 5 to 10? I mean, what does that mean in real, you know what I mean?
It means above 5.
So, I mean, how much is that? Is that a lot? I mean, I don't know, you know.
Well, what it means is that they were using 10, and then as they studied it, they found the children being negatively impacted at 5 micrograms per deciliter or more. So, and they've also found, like radiation, there's no safe level. But 5 is the standard the Center for Disease Control and Prevention has adopted. And because there's a negative impact that's clear above 5 deciliters, or 5 micrograms, that's the standard the state should adopt.
Is that what other states have?
I'm not familiar with what all the states have. I know nationwide, Reuters did a study and found there were 3,800 neighborhoods in the country with lead levels in the children twice the level of Flint, Michigan. So it is a nationwide problem. And, you know, my hunch is it's not had been a top priority elsewhere as well as it hasn't been here.
About lead paint in homes, would that not be a little bit more difficult to control in terms of how you put funding into that? How would you stop lead paint from hurting children in their own homes?
Well, you test the children, see what their blood levels are. And then when you test for lead in the, and if there is a problem, you've got to do abatement. But that's what I'm talking about, lead testing certification. There are ways, in fact, they've got newer technology that uses some kind of, you know, like radiation to test where the lead is so you can see it. It doesn't mean you have to remove all the lead, you can encapsulate it by painting over all lead. And that's the way a lot of it is done. But then you've got to make sure that the new paint isn't peeling away and exposing the old paint. That's why you need regular inspections.
Like you said, it's 46 years old, this problem, and we still can't get a grip on it. Is that just because the government isn't doing enough?
Yeah, I think the problem is the government looks after the people that are paying the campaign contributions. And in urban politics, and you look at Cuomo's donors, the real estate industry is huge. And they don't want the expense of fixing up their rental properties. So I think, you know, when push comes to shove, low-income people that are living in this older housing don't have the same clout that the wealthy real estate barons do. I think explains why this has not been a high priority. But poisoning our children should be a concern of all of us. It costs more to deal with children that have problems and end up in the criminal justice system and can't perform well at work than it does to fix the problem up front.
Would these be a legislative thing, or is it executive order kind of things?
I think it requires legislation.
For all of them, all five?
Yeah, to the extent the governor has discretionary funding, he could put that money, like he put $250 million into NYCHA when this controversy arose with NYCHA's misreporting. But mainly, it's got to be state policy, state law that we've got to change. And the budget. The governor has a lot to do with the budget. The budget's got to have the money for the cities. And we can go into financing. You know, I've called for restoring the revenue sharing that the cities used to get. Right now they're squeezed between the 2% property tax cap and the limits on what the property tax can raise anyway. And they have all these unfunded mandates from the state, which then means they got to, our property taxes have gone up because the state doesn't share revenues like it used to do from the more progressive income tax. So look, the state, the top 1% in the state got 12% of all income in 1980. Today they get 30%, yet their taxes have been cut. And actually, the bottom bracket for low-wage workers has been doubled from 2 to 4%. So with more progressive taxation, we can give some relief to, you know, working-class people, but also have enough money to you know, deal with problems like child lead poisoning.
Where does this stand in other terms of central New York health problems? We have the opioid epidemic, we have skinny atlas algae. Why is this a top priority for you?
Children can't defend themselves. You know, if you hear there's an algae bloom, you know you can avoid the water, don't eat the fish. Opioid addiction is definitely a problem. I mean, all these problems have to be addressed. But lead has been kicked to the back of the line for too long. 40% of the children in Syracuse are lead poisoned. It's affecting their lives. And these are little kids that, you know, they're not responsible for these things yet because they're not adults. So to me, that's got to be a top priority.
And can I ask you about your election right now? Is it different than what you're expecting with the corruption happening and the current political office that's going on? Are you expecting this to be going the way it is, or has it been different?
It's about going the way I expected. You know, our argument to the people is we're outside the corrupt two-party system, and we see politicians from both parties getting convicted just in the last week, really, and their campaign contributors. We're talking about bribery, bid rigging, extortion. I mean, to expect these two parties that have acted so corruptly and wasted so much money on economic development projects that don't develop the economy but have the pockets of campaign donors, we got to get outside the box. And that's what we're offering. I mean, we're not running as Greens because it's the easiest way to get elected. We're not just running for office, we're running to change things. And if we get in office, that's what we'll do.
City of Syracuse, it's a municipal water supply, right? Do they currently offer any home lead testing kits to the customers, you know?
I don't know if they offer kits. The water is pretty good from Skinny Atlas Lake, except now with the algae bloom problem, which may mean we need to get filtration, because that problem's spreading as the climate warms.
I think that's one of the things we saw in Flint, too. It wasn't necessarily the source delivery, the pipes that went right to the street, but maybe from there into the houses, because these older homes were constructed
right
and never updated.
They have lead service delivery. The problem in Flint was they had the state take over the management of the city, and they thought they'd save money by, instead of getting the money from the water from the Detroit system, they got it locally. That water turned out to be acidic and corroding the lead, and it got into the drinking water and people got poisoned. Here the thing is, there are ways to, and this has been recommended to people, like if you have a lead service line, run the water some before you use it for drinking or cooking, and that reduces the amount of lead. It's expensive to replace those lead service lines. And as far as the testing goes, I'm not sure, you know, who can offer testing, but you know, it'd be a good idea for homeowners and landlords to do that. And you know, in terms of dealing with the lead problem, the primary source of this lead is lead in the homes from paint, lead paint, in these homes that were built before 1978. But the water can add to that.
And as far as certifying rental properties, do you foresee as that point in your plan, would that be a city like zoning person? Are you looking, is that a state kind of, what do you think would be the most effective way to certify these rental homes?
I would want it to be a state law that would be administered by local government. And the state, because it's a state law, should provide the funding so that the cities like Syracuse, which are, you know, really tight for money, have the money to do that.
What are we talking about money-wise? I mean, comparatively, let's say comparatively to all the money they're handing out for economic development projects, would this, like, be on the same level as that or less, or do you have any sense?
I do not have a budget for that. But we're spending about $4 billion a year at the state level and another $4 billion through the Industrial Development Agencies. That's $8 billion going to subsidize private businesses. That's one source of money. But in terms of what it would cost, I don't have an estimate for you. But I know, you know, what price do you put on a child's health?
Are there any one of these five proposals that you think is the most important?
I think they all come together as a package. I think probably the most significant is the lead safe certification, because that'll force the landlords to clean up their units. And that's a source of funding. Landlords have been doing well in this state, You know, the rent is too damn high. And, you know, New York City, everybody knows the working class is being driven out of Manhattan and Brooklyn. But there was a study recently that looked at the top 25 cities in the country with the highest rent hikes. Buffalo was number 3. New York City wasn't even on that list. So it's a big problem. I mean, here in Syracuse, if you can get the credit and buy a home, you get a good deal. But if you got to rent, there's not enough affordable housing, so it's a seller's market for the landlords, and rents are very high. And they've been going up. So that's a whole other issue, the housing issue. We'll do a news conference on that. We did one over at Kennedy Square, but we'll be going back to that one. Because, you know, my sense, you asked about how the campaign's going. What I'm hearing from working class people is the rents are rising, the health care costs are rising, and my wages are stagnant. We just can't pay our bills. We can't even stay in our homes. And I think, you know, there's millions of New Yorkers that are feeling that pinch, and we're trying to address that problem.
Do you think the lead contamination issue will compel people to vote for you, this particular issue?
I hope so. I hope people care about, you know, the health of our children. I know in New York City it's a big issue. You know, people are outraged. There are 400,000 people in public housing, and, you know, a lot of those people are children. And now that they've been sort of caught with their pants down, misleading the feds and undercounting the number of kids that have been poisoned, they've now committed to inspect 135,000 units. Now, the federal government, just in terms of funding for lead programs, increased actually by $30 million to $260 million for the nationwide program. But that only covers 15,500 units, and only 1,500 units targeted for public housing. So it shows, you know, that there's a great need, but the money's not being put there.
The bottom line, the state needs to put money, invest money in this particular problem.
Yeah, the feds should too, but with the government we got in Washington right now, we can't count on them until it changes. So, you know, we should start at the state level and step up.
Just on the campaign, with the primary, the incumbent, he's going to have to primary. What does that do for you or for any third-party candidate? Is this helpful?
No, it's kind of cuts both ways. And we saw this when Zephyr Teachout ran against Cuomo last time. While the primary's on, the media's focused on that horse race, and the progressives are putting money into that race. And then after but they kind of gather a group of people that are upset with Governor Cuomo, and then they're looking at their options after the primary. And, you know, we figure half our votes came from the Teachout vote. We both got just short of 200,000 votes, she in the primary, me in the general. So it cuts both ways. I mean, right now during the summer, a lot of progressive Democrats who like our program, but, you know, they're going to vote in the primary, they're focused on the Nixon race. So it's a mixed bag.
And then if Nixon decides to keep running on the working family, then that really would cut into your...
Well, there was a poll out yesterday that showed that actually, no, it's Nixon and Minor that take from each other after the primary. And I maintain 4 or 5%. So I think we got a core vote of progressives and socialists who've decided the two-party system is not going to get it done. The question is, how much can we reach into those progressives who still have hope in the Democratic Party or independents and looking for progressive options will come our way in the fall. And in a 5 or 6 way race, I mean, who knows what can happen? It's, 25% could win it. So I think we got a program that addresses the issues that people are concerned about. And if they go for the program,
you know, we can win. What was the poll?
That was Zogby.
And was everybody? I'll look it up. I didn't.
Yeah, everybody, but yeah. They left the Libertarian out. He's not on the ballot yet. I guess that was the reason.
Okay.
So.
How do you go from a mayoral election to a statewide election? How do you change your strategy for that?
Well, mayoral election is in a city, smaller scale, so you can do a lot more retail door-to-door knocking, talking to voters one-on-one. And there was a lot more media attention. I mean, I think I got a fair hearing in terms for those people that were following the newspaper, the radio, the TV debates. When you run for statewide office, the earned media, because we don't have a budget to buy a lot of ads, is very important. And so narrative that the media sets is key. And at this point, the narrative's generally leaving me out. You know, there'll be an article on what do people think about the tax cap. Cuomo wants to keep it, Marlon Mantanaro wants to make it permanent, Nixon wants to reform it, I want to eliminate it, you know, and let local communities decide their own priorities and have the state restore the revenue sharing because the property taxes haven't gone down with this tax cap. But most of the stories written about that issue a few weeks ago didn't mention me in our program. So that's frustrating. And so we're trying to get into the narrative. It makes such a big difference. There was a poll in one of these online polls that somebody sent to me, and they said, you know, what do you think would be the biggest difference in the fall elections? And they had, you know, campaign money, and they had like five options, and then other. I put the mainstream media narrative that kind of sets the tone or the frame in which people at least follow the news think about it.
Is it easier to run when you don't have a nighttime job?
It is, because I can, you know, I don't have to several times a week get up with inadequate sleep and then try to get a nap before I go back to work. So yeah, I'm having a lot more good days. Let's put it that way.
You mentioned debate. Anything on the radar for debate, or are you going to wait until after the Democratic primary shapes things up a little better?
The Manhattan Neighborhood Network, which is public access, which people in Syracuse wouldn't believe what they got down there, it reaches 600,000 households. It's, you know, it's easy to find on the, you know, the dial. They've called it a debate, and they're going to have it whether or not Cuomo comes. The problem when I ran against him in 2010 and 2014 is none of the media organizations would hold a debate unless he showed up. That enabled him to set the terms. So 2010 we did one in Hofstra, and 2014 we did one in Buffalo that NPR covered. So I emerged in the media, you know, you should be in charge. Set the debates. If Cuomo doesn't show up, that's on him. And we'll have a good debate without him. And if we start having those kind of debates, I think he'll feel pressured to come, compelled to come, because otherwise there'll be five of us beating up on him. You know, he's got to answer for himself.
But he really doesn't. I mean, he can just, you know, get votes just because he's an incumbent.
Yeah, but if it keeps happening, and, you know, editorials, you know, there'll be a lot of outrage, you know, Andrew, what are you afraid of? Why aren't you showing up? And he's got broad support, but I think it's thin. I think a lot of his support is name recognition, but, you know, people, I wouldn't call him, you know, his supporters are not, you know, very enthusiastic about him. It's like, you know, we get what we need from him, like the unions, you know, we got some deals, and, you know, the devil you know is better than the one you don't. So I think that's their attitude. So his support, I don't think, is that deep. And, you know, if we start having debates without him there and people start listening, he could be in trouble.
Is there anything else we forgot to ask that you would like to talk about?
Oh, okay.
Not like to talk about, but for this specific issue that you forgot to mention.
On lead. No, I think I covered my points on the lead issue.
Okay, thank you.
But I will be on media availability on phone at 1 o'clock. And I want to talk about some other things there as well as lead.
Okay, thank you.
You said that's by phone?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And you sent that info, I'm sure, to our
planning. Yeah, I saw that. Anything in particular you're going to talk about that's going to be newsworthy? This probably got everything.
Well, yeah. I want to hit Cuomo again on why he hasn't asked Barbara Underwood to open a criminal investigation of the Trump family and their foundation. You know, she referred to the IRS and FEC violations of self-dealing and campaign violations. And David K. Johnston had an editorial on July 4th in the New York Times. And Cuomo says he's so much opposed to Trump. I mean, David K. Johnston said this will likely get the tax returns that Trump won't show into the public record when the, you know, a criminal case is filed by the Attorney General. The Attorney General can't file a criminal case there. It's not their purview unless asked by the government. It's more the U.S. attorneys and the district attorneys that do the criminal investigations. So I don't understand why Cuomo is waiting on that.